This conference will now be recorded.
So we shall begin with another smaller topic from your syllabus. Last time we finished about renal function tests. The next topic, subtopic in the same unit is about liver function tests. Quickly, we shall observe the human anatomy and physiology of the liver. I am sure you are already aware about it. The liver is the largest organ that is present in our body, which is weighing around 1.5 kg. And it is situated in the abdominal cavity below our diaphragm. The cells which come together to form the liver organ are called as the hepatocytes. And there are two lobes into which the liver is divided. That is the called as the hepatic lobes. So these two lobes are the structural and functional units for the liver, and one of the main things that is secreted out from the liver is the bile juice, which aids the digestion for fats. It emulsifies the fat and it aids in the metabolism of the fats that are present in our diet. The liver is like a filter which is present, or a factory of filter which is present in our body, and we have to be very careful, or we have to be very vigilant about taking care of this organ. Whatever we consume in the form of food, either liquid or solid, everything will pass through this liver and it will be filtered, and then only it will be distributed in the body. So liver, the organ itself, is a very important organ for the normal functioning of our digestion, as well as overall well-being. Now, if you decide to classify the different functions that the liver performs, we can classify them as metabolic functions, excretory functions, hematological functions, detoxification, and storage. Okay, so each of these functions of the liver are very important, and the tests that we do for liver function test, or to study whether the liver is functioning properly or no, they are based on all these functions of liver. From the beginning itself, we have been seeing a lot of metabolic cycles, biochemical cycles, and all of them we have been mentioning that they occur in the hepatocellular cells. Okay, so whether it is carbohydrates, is a very dangerous substance for the functioning of brain, so it should not be present in our blood plasma. Therefore, detoxification of the ammonia that is formed during protein metabolism is done by the hepatocellular cells. So this comes under the protective functions or the detoxification functions of the liver. Other than this, bile pigments, bile salts, and cholesterol is also excreted in the bile. And from that bile, it enters into the intestine. Liver is also known to be storing glycogen and vitamin A, vitamin B12, and trace elements of iron. One of the reasons that it is storing iron is because it has to perform a hematological function. And this hematological functions involves the synthesis of plasma proteins, destruction of erythrocytes, and then obviously the formation of the blood also. Okay, so taking into consideration all these functions that the liver organ, the gland, is performing, it is a very imperative gland in our body. Of course, if there is liver cirrhosis, or if the liver is not functioning properly, the last stage of action is definitely the liver transplant, but like I told you about kidneys also, it is not so easy to get a liver or a kidney transplant or a matching donor for the same. Now, various reasons are there as to why the liver function would not be taking place properly. Having alcohol, you know, there is a disease which is called as alcoholic cirrhosis or liver cirrhosis, which is caused due to alcohol. Then there is a fatty and non-fatty liver, which is developed. That is the deposition of lot of fat on the liver is fatty, development of fatty liver. And over a period of time, there will be pain in the place. And you will need scanning and all to identify that there is a fatty liver which has been developed. Slowly, different types of problems will start involving development of jaundice or development of hepatitis and storage of unwanted or unnecessary material, which is going to cause different types of further complications in the body. So what do you do to identify whether the liver is functioning properly or no? There are a series of tests which have been designed to identify or to study whether the functioning of the liver is happening properly or no. And like I told you in the beginning, all these tests are based on your functions which the liver is going to perform. So the classification of these liver function tests is as follows: tests based to study the excretory function of the liver, tests based to study the serum enzymes, tests based for seeing the synthetic functioning of the liver, seeing the or studying the metabolic capacity of the liver, and the test based to seeing the detoxification capacity of the liver. So we will be seeing the different tests under each of these categories one by one. We shall begin with the first one, that is the excretory function of the liver. Under excretory function of the liver, what is involved is the excretion of cholesterol, excretion of bile pigments and bile salts. When we were doing the protein metabolism chapter, we saw that bilirubin, biliverdin, urobilinogen are some of the substances which are formed, and these substances are formed in the liver. They have to be excreted out by the liver into the intestines so that they can go into the further path. That is, bilirubin will form biliverdin and it will get later get converted to stercobilin and urobilinogen, and then respectively through the fecal matter and through the urine they have to be excreted out. They are all color pigments. Now in the case of the excretory function test, what is measured is the concentration of the bile salts and the bile pigments. Obviously, the increase in the levels of bile salts and bile pigments, you are aware that disease is known as jaundice, where the bilirubin starts getting deposited and you start identifying or you start seeing the symptoms where the eyes turn yellow, the skin turns yellow in color, the excess bilirubin is getting excreted out from the urine also, and the straw colored urine or the yellow straw colored urine is becoming very dark yellow in color. Now this bilirubin is existing in two forms in the body: unconjugated form of the bilirubin and the conjugated form of the bilirubin. So in the serum there or in the blood there will be presence of both unconjugated as well as conjugated form of bilirubin. The serum bilirubin normal range is about 0.2 to 1 microgram per dl. And out of this, around 75% is the conjugated bilirubin. The remaining 25% is the unconjugated bilirubin, which is present in the serum. Now, there are two different tests that are available for identifying the presence of unconjugated bilirubin as well as the identification of conjugated bilirubin as well. So this direct or indirect test is referred to as Van Den Berg reaction. Okay, So there is a direct van den Berg reaction and there is an indirect van den Berg reaction. One is to identify the presence of conjugated bilirubin. The other is to identify the presence of non-conjugated bilirubin. So the non-conjugated bilirubin is identified by the indirect positive test of van den Berg reaction. So this indirect positive test or the van den Berg indirect test involves the addition of methanol, or it uses methanol, where the unconjugated bilirubin gets dissolved in methanol, and after that a purple color is produced or a purple color is developed after the addition of alcohol, after 30 minutes of addition of alcohol. And then from this, by using a calorimeter, you can check the concentration of the presence of unconjugated bilirubin in the serum sample that you are using. Similarly, conjugated bilirubin is actually insoluble in water. Unconjugated bilirubin is actually insoluble in water. So conjugated bilirubin will solubilize in water. I told you in the serum, both unconjugated and conjugated both are present. So your unconjugated bilirubin will solubilize in methanol and it will give you a purple color, whereas the conjugated bilirubin will solubilize in water and it will give you a purple color. Along with that, van den Berg reagent is also used to give the purple color. Both of them are studied calorimetrically. There is a machine which is called as a calorimeter, and with the help of the machine, the concentration of the unconjugated as well as conjugated bilirubin in the serum can be identified. And once you get the concentration, you can then compare it to the standard concentration of the bilirubin that should be present. Like I mentioned, the normal range is 0.2 to 1 microgram per dl. So for conjugated bilirubin, the normal range for it is 0.2 to 0.4 milligram per dl, and for unconjugated bilirubin it is 0.2 to 0.6 milligram per dl. So when you do these tests, both the direct as well as indirect test on the serum to identify bilirubin, you will get a range after the calculations. And after you get the range, you are going to compare it with these normal ranges I have just mentioned, and then you can tell whether the liver functioning is happening properly or no, or the excretory functioning of the liver is happening properly or no. If the values of the unconjugated and conjugated bilirubin do not fall into this range which I mentioned, then you can say that there is either presence of obstructive jaundice. Like if your direct positive, that is the conjugated bilirubin levels, are very high, then you say that there is obstructive jaundice. Or if the indirect test, that is when you are using methanol for identifying unconjugated bilirubin presence, when the values over there in of that range are very high, then you call it as hemolytic jaundice. Okay, and if both the values are high, then you say that there is hepatic jaundice. It is called as biphasic situation, and it is called as hepatic jaundice. Okay, so this is the van den Berg reaction, which is utilized to identify the presence of or the concentration of serum bilirubin in both conjugated as well as unconjugated forms, and then further classify as to what type of jaundice the patient is suffering from. The next test is the bromosulfaphthalein test. If you recollect, when we did the kidney function test, we used a substance called as inulin. Okay, and I told you that there are a lot of inert substances that are used to study whether organ functioning is happening properly or no. So in the case of kidney function test, we were using inulin to see whether the inulin is getting excreted out from the body and how long is it taking for the inulin to get excreted out. Similarly, here another inert substance is given intravenously, and the dose is 5 milligram per kg of the body weight. It is a non-toxic substance. It has no functioning in the body. It does not cause any harm. And this is a dye which is called as bromosulfaphthalene. And normally, this dye should get excreted out from the liver through bile within a time of 45 minutes to 2 hours. Now, if the dye is not getting excreted out from the body, that means it is getting retained in the body. There is excessive retention of this particular dye in the body. Then you say that the liver function of excretion has been impaired. Okay, so this is about the bromosulfaphthalene test. So for studying the excretory function of the liver or excretory functioning of the liver, there are two different types of tests that are involved: Van der Berg reaction and bromosulfaphthalene reaction. Van der Berg reaction is used to identify presence of conjugated as well as unconjugated type of bilirubin. Two different types of solutions are used. One is a water solution and other is the solution for using methanol, and the Van der Berg dye is added. Both the tests give purple color through colorimetric through using a calorimeter or through a colorimetric titration. You can identify the concentration of the bilirubin that is present and then conclude what type of jaundice the patient is suffering from, like it is hemolytic jaundice, obstructive jaundice, or hepatic jaundice. Okay, the next set or the next type of test that is done to study the liver functioning is the test which is based on the enzymes which are there in the liver. The liver is having around 4 to 5 different types of enzymes, and the most common are SGOT, SGPT, ALP, and GGT. Now, these enzymes are having several functions in the liver, and when the liver is damaged, the concentration or the levels of these enzymes can increase or decrease. Most of the times, they increase. So you can use these serum enzymes or the level of these serum enzymes, and they can provide you valuable information about the functioning of the liver. Okay, so like I told you, these enzymes, the transaminase enzymes, SGOT or SGPT, the alkaline phosphatase enzyme, the gamma glutamyl enzyme, that is the GGT, gamma glutamyl transpeptidase enzymes, these are the different enzymes which you can whose levels you can study, and you can identify the functioning of the liver or if there is any hepatic damage. So these transaminase enzymes, these are two enzymes, the serum glutamate pyruvate transaminase, that is SGOT, and the other is the serum glutamate oxaloacetate transaminase enzyme, SGOT and SGPT. So they have specific ranges, or there is a specific normal range for all these types of enzymes. And when the value is determined, the prognostic value is determined of these enzymes, then you can correlate them to their particular ranges, and then say whether there is a liver functioning which is happening normally or there is an abnormality in the liver function. Similarly, there is another enzyme, that is the alkaline phosphate enzyme. Now this enzyme is basically derived from bones also and from the hepatocellular cells also, and the rise in an serum ALP level or an elevated serum ALP level is associated with rise in the serum bilirubin level also. So you will not be doing only serum enzyme test, you will be doing the excretory tests also. So in one place, with the help of identifying the levels of ALP or the levels of alkaline phosphatase enzyme, you will be able to correlate it to the elevated levels of serum bilirubin, and this can be then confirmed by doing the van den Berg reaction, where you are identifying the actual concentration of conjugated and non-conjugated bilirubin, and this is an indication of presence of hepatitis or jaundice, and then further treatment could be started seeing these values. The next enzyme that could be evaluated is the gamma glutamyl transpeptidase enzyme, or what is known as the GGT enzyme. Now this is a microsomal enzyme and it is widely distributed in our body tissues, including the liver. So a serum GGT level is identified. The normal serum GGT level is around 5 to 40 IU per L, and if there is a rise in the serum GGT level, then it can be associated with the biliary obstruction, or it can be associated to alcoholism, or it can be associated to certain drugs. Like certain drugs, when you take, the GGT level increases. Like for example, if you are an epileptic patient, there will be you, and if you are being treated with phenytoin, then the levels of serum GGT are higher, and again this could be correlated to the presence of excess of bilirubin or the rise in the serum bilirubin level. Okay, so these are some of the serum enzymes that you can study for identifying whether the liver functioning is happening properly or no. Another serum enzyme that you could study and associate it with liver functioning is the 5-nucleotidase enzyme. The normal level for the 5-nucleotidase enzyme is 215 IU per liter, and an elevated level of the 5-nucleotidase enzyme is associated again with hepatobiliary dysfunctioning. Other than this, there are different enzymes that you could associate liver functioning. Like for example, you could study LDH4 and LDH5 enzymes also. LDH stands for lactate dehydrogenase enzyme, and this enzyme and the isocitrate dehydrogenase enzyme are also secreted in the liver. And if you estimate the level of the serum level of both these enzymes, you could associate it with the functioning of the liver, whether it is abnormal or normal. And most of the time, an elevated level of these transaminase enzymes or alkaline phosphatase enzyme or GGT is associated with biliary obstruction in the liver. So further investigation after this, you can start, or you can start the treatment straight away. The next is the synthetic functioning of liver, or the synthetic functioning tests, which are based on the synthetic functioning of liver. There are two types. One is the serum proteins and the other is the prothrombin time. Okay. Now in serum proteins, we are individually focusing on albumin. Albumin is one protein which is synthesized in the liver, and this albumin is a good biomarker, or if you which means or what I mean to say is that when you are able to study the levels of albumin, or you are able to identify the levels of albumin in the serum, then you can estimate the liver damage, whether there is a high level of liver damage or the liver damage is very minimal. So this albumin has a half life of about 20 to 25 days, and if the serum albumin levels are low, then it is associated with liver damage. Also, it can be associated with malnutrition. Similarly, if the levels of serum albumin are high, then it is associated with liver cirrhosis. So by estimating the levels of serum protein, specifically albumin, you can correlated to the synthetic functioning of the liver, whether it is happening properly or no. There are a lot of blood clotting factors that are associated when blood has to clot in the body, and one of the factors that are estimated is the prothrombin time. That means how much of time is the wound or the cut taking for clotting to happen. So this is what is called as blood clotting, or it is also called as the acute liver damage. So when there is prolonged bleeding, or the prothrombin time is prolonged, or the blood clotting is happening after a prolonged time, it can be straight away correlated to having a either chronic or acute liver damage. Of course, along with this, vitamin K and other blood clotting factors, the levels of these blood clotting factors, everything is essential. So you also need to check, along with this prothrombin time, whether there is vitamin K deficiency or no. Because in case there is vitamin K deficiency, then also this prothrombin time will be elevated, or it will take longer for the blood clotting to happen. The next we are going to evaluate, or we are going to analyze about the liver, is its metabolic capacity. So to study the metabolic capacity of the liver, one of the primary substances that is tested is the galactose. Okay, now you are aware, we did it in the introduction of carbohydrates, that galactose is a monosaccharide and it is exclusively metabolized only in the liver. So in this case, the levels of galactose are studied. So intravenous administration of galactose is done. The dose for this is 300 milligrams per kg of body weight, and the blood is withdrawn at 10 minutes of intervals for the next 2 hours, and the serum galactose levels are checked. So if the serum galactose levels in normal individuals, it should be the half life of the galactose is 10 to 15 minutes. But if there is infective hepatitis, or the patient is suffering from cirrhosis, then this half life is greatly elevated. Okay, so galactose, which should have come in the serum in 10 to 15 minutes, is going to come into the serum after a very prolonged period of time. And this is an indicative that there is hepatocellular damage. So after the injection of galactose is given, there is evaluation of the galactose levels by taking the blood samples at specific intervals of 10 minutes. And when the individual is having a normal liver functioning, in within 10 to 15 minutes, the galactose is seen in the serum. But this will not happen in the case of patients who are having hepatocellular damage, and you associate this to the metabolic incapacity of the liver to excrete out or to metabolize galactose. The last part about liver function test is to test it for its detoxification capacity. And to test it for its detoxification capacity, we are using another substance which is called as hippuric acid. Now, the liver is a major site, I told you, for detoxification to happen. And what we are doing in this test is we are seeing the capacity of the liver to detoxify it from hippuric acid. So in this case, what is done is sodium benzoate is given to the patient. The patient is made, or the subject is made, to drink sodium benzoate. And this sodium benzoate has to get excreted out from the body. Now, this sodium benzoate gets converted to hippuric acid in the liver, and the hippuric acid levels can be checked in the urine samples. So, after the sodium benzoate and hippuric acid is given to the patient, after about an hour or so, this sodium benzoate as well as hippuric acid should get excreted out from the body completely. However, in patients who are having liver damage, or there is liver cirrhosis or hepatitis, this happens after a prolonged period of time, or the entire sodium benzoate as well as hippuric acid does not get excreted out from the body. Okay, so a reduced level of hippuric acid identified in the urine sample is an indication that the detoxification capacity of the liver is not up to the mark. And because of this, you can conclude that there is liver damage, or the patient is suffering from liver cirrhosis or hepatitis, or there is liver damage. Okay, so this is a test which is done for the process of for identifying whether the process of detoxification is going to ha is happening properly in the liver or no. So with the help of all these biochemical tests, we can conclude whether the liver is functioning properly or no, and we can also then take the further line of action with the help of the readings that you are going to get from these biochemical investigations. You cannot do only one test and then conclude that the liver is not functioning properly. You have to do a permutation and combination of all these tests, which we discussed just now, and then only you can say that there is liver damage, or there is hepatitis, or the liver is not able to do its functions up to the mark. Okay, so with this we complete the another small topic of liver function test.